And I pray that you and I can see what the word of the Lord has to say to us. The word of the Lord is truth. The Lord will never operate in half truths. He'll never operate in deceit, in deception. He'll never operate in lies. But the Lord operates always. The Holy Spirit will always operate in truth. Never in anything else. Now, I want to say this to you and to me. And I always include myself in this because we are all a part of the body of Christ. I want to say this, and I want you to hear me clearly. There are so many things being said, being taught. And I mean, if you don't know your Bible, first of all, if you don't know the Holy Spirit, if you don't have a real connection to the Holy Spirit, because the Bible says that the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of truth, will lead you and guide you into all truth. He'll never lead you in any other direction except in truth. Never. And he'll never lead you in any other direction except the Word. Are you with me? The Spirit and the Word go hand in hand. He doesn't operate on concepts or what anybody thinks or any of those kind of things. He operates in the truth of God's Word. That's what's truth. The Holy Spirit will lead you there. That's how he leads everybody. You got to have a connection. You got to have a relationship going with the Holy Spirit so that the Spirit can lead you. Then you got to have a relationship going with the Word. Because if you just have, a lot of people have a lot of word, but they have no interpretation of that word because the Spirit isn't there. And so they interpret their own, or they grab an interpretation from somebody else. There's so many things going today. And many of the things that are going today, listen to me tonight, are not truth. And the Holy Spirit will bring you to a place of knowing the true from the false. Say truth from false. He'll never lead you. He'll never lead you, I'm telling you tonight, into falsehood. Never will he take you in that direction. He did not save you to lead you astray. But he saved you to make sure that you would make it all the way. Are you with me tonight? This is his mission. This is one of the main missions of the Holy Spirit, is to help you and I make it all the way. Now I want to say this to you, but because you have a will of your own, the Holy Spirit will tug at your heart, but you have a will. You have a will. And there's a lot of things that sound so spiritual, and they sound so great, and they sound so exciting. But they're not true. And you got to be able to discern by the Holy Spirit and by the Word of God what it is. I had a preacher tell me, an old-time preacher tell me just the other day, and I have a lot of respect for him, But he told me this the other day. He said, Ray, don't get your church to join the fun church. See, because there's a lot of Christians that believe that church should only just be fun. But how many know that it's not just fun? It's got to be a time of growth. I mean, it's got to be a relationship with God. And sometimes you're not going to have fun. Sometimes you're going to go through trials. You're going to go through certain things in life. You're going to cry. You're going to... Come on, is there anybody home? And there are so many things happening in our day, right now. And you gotta have this. And I said this morning, as gifts, as pastors, evangelists, apostles, prophets, teachers, we have to teach you, or we have to warn you, or we have to show you. But we can't make you receive it. See, that's something, no matter what, I've dealt with people, I've been dealing with people for a long time. And there are some people sometimes that no matter what you tell them, no matter what you show them, I show them the Word in black and white, written by the Spirit of the Lord. Man, I show them, I even show them in their own Bible, and they still refuse to believe. Because see, they're only going to believe whatever they want. If you want to accept falsehood, whatever is false, nobody can make you accept truth. Nobody. You see, everyone that's going to go to heaven, according to the Word of God, must be born again. Amen. It doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, doesn't matter if you're Jew or Gentile, you got to be born again. Yes, amen. One day Jesus, and this is New Testament, one day Jesus is talking to a Jew by the name of Nicodemus. How many remember that story? And Nicodemus tells him, well, what do I got to do to inherit eternal life? What do I got to do? And Jesus said, Nicodemus, you're a teacher of the law. You know, he was a Pharisee. Yeah. He came at night because he didn't want anybody to know that he knew Jesus, that he had come to Christ, that he didn't want him to be seen talking to him because he was afraid they'd throw him out. So he became a secret agent. He was the first secret agent, You thought you were, but listen, you were not the first one. And he was a Jew, and he came to Jesus. And he told, and Jesus looked at him and said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. You have to be born again of the Spirit and of the water. Of the Spirit and of the Word. You must be born again. You can't enter into heaven unless you are born again. And that includes every human being in the world. They must be born again. So listen to me. Look up here at me. I want you to look up here at me. And I'm not here to judge anybody. I'm not here to put down anybody. I'm just here to tell you the truth. Can I tell you the truth? Amen. You can wear all the prayer shawls you want to. But if you're not born again, you ain't going to heaven.
Amen.
Eat all the shoe bread you want to. burn all the candles. But if you're not born again, you're not going to heaven. You must be born again. You must be born again. It doesn't matter who we are. You have to be born again. Jesus Christ gave his life on a cross. And whoever is going to go to heaven has got to go through Jesus Christ. We got to go through that sacrifice. Is there anybody home? He is the ultimate sacrifice. He is everything. I'm going to give you a story real quickly here, because that's not the only thing that's going around. There's many things going around. See, you can wear a prayer shawl, but that don't make you a born-again believer. I mean, you could, many individuals look at you, maybe think that you're real religious or real spiritual, but that doesn't mean you are. You can carry a gallon of anointing oil. But if you're not born again, I don't care what you carry, you're not going nowhere. All right, anybody home? I remember one day I was doing a program, a television program on Daystar, and I was there together with a rabbi, a real nice man. We were there together, and this man asked me a question. He began to ask me my name first of all, and I introduced myself to him, and he had introduced himself to me, and I introduced myself to him, and when he heard what my name was, then he asked me where I was originally from, and I told him where I was from, and after he heard where I was from, he looked at me and he said this to me. He said, "You are a Jew." I looked at him and I said to myself, I didn't say to him, I said to myself, "Man, this guy's on a trip." I didn't say anything. I just said, "Wow." And I just said, "Okay," I just sat down and I'm checking him out, because all I've ever known is Ora Levato and all that, I've never known any other thing, And I'm just checking it out, and I'm saying to myself, "Where is this thing coming from?" So he began to tell me a story of the Inquisition that took place in Rome with the Jews. And he gave me the year, and he went on and on and on, and he began to share with me how the Jews fled from Rome and they came to America, and they landed here in America, and many of them landed in the state of New Mexico, and they landed in the city of Santa Fe, many of them, they changed their names to Spaniard names because they didn't want to be found. And they went on, he went on with a big old story, but I walked out of there, I was dizzy. All right? But then one day, a few weeks later, I'm sitting in my office. My office was back here. I was sitting in my office when all of a sudden I get a big brown envelope like that from a friend of mine in New Mexico. And he sends me three full pages of the New Mexican. And that story that man told me 2 weeks earlier was in that paper. Was that a coincidence? I don't know. But I want to say this. It doesn't matter if you're Jew, Gentile, whatever you are, what religion, what faith, whatever, you must be born again. Gotta be saved. Oh, give him praise. Give him praise. Okay. So then, there's so many things going on in our time. If the enemy cannot get you to go backwards, and accept a false doctrine and get you to go backwards and fall, get back into sin and believe that it's okay, that God's allowing it, that the grace is allowing you to live a lifestyle of sin and it's all right with God, then he's going to use a religion of some kind, a spiritual thing, to try to get to you, because he knows he's not going to get you to go back. He's going to try to get you to believe something spiritual. Are you with me tonight? You've got to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit and with the Word of God. You've got to have that. The Spirit of the Lord has got to be able to speak to your heart. He's got to be able to quicken you. When something isn't right, when something isn't right there, I mean, the Spirit of the Lord has got to be able to speak to you, and you've got to be able to either get up and leave or say something and correct that thing. Come on, is anybody home? Now, what would the devil want to mess with you for? What would he want to mess with so many individuals for? Okay, because I want you to see something with me. Go with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and we're going to read from verse 14 down. All right? Verse 14 down. And look what it says. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will also bring with him through Jesus those who have fallen asleep in death. All right, let's go on. For this we declare to you by the Lord's own word, not by anybody else's, but by the Lord's own word, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall in no way proceed into his presence or have any advantage at all over those who have previously fallen asleep in him in death. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a loud cry of summons, with the shout of an archangel, and with a blast of a trumpet of God. And those who have departed this life in Christ will rise first. Are you with me? Now this is what he's saying. He's saying that the Lord will come in the clouds with the archangel. The trumpet will sound. He's going to call his people, his children, first of all, those that have died first. Are you with me? They're going to rise up to meet the Lord in the air, to be taken with him. Look at this. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a loud cry of summons. Remember Lazarus in the tomb? Lazarus, come forth! He summoned Lazarus. Why just Lazarus? Because if he had just said, come forth, everybody that was dead would have come forth. He had to just call him. So look at this. With the shout of an archangel and with a blast of the trumpet of God, and those who have departed this life in Christ will rise first. Those that have fallen asleep, those that have died, will rise up first. Let's go on. Then we, the living ones who remain on the earth, shall simultaneously be caught up. Say, caught up. Along with the resurrected dead in the clouds. In a twinkling of an eye. In a twinkling of an eye. Not a blink. A twinkle. Millions and millions and millions and millions of people disappearing in one twinkle off the face of the earth. Are you with me, church? People that are born again, that are living for Jesus Christ. Are you here tonight, church? That are not following all kinds of different beliefs and falling into every trap of the enemy. They've got a relationship with the Holy Spirit. They got a relationship with the Word of God. Come on, is there anybody here today? I said, is there anybody home today? They don't believe everything they hear. They're not searching for new things. Listen, they're satisfied with Jesus. I'm going to tell you something tonight. If Jesus is not enough for you, then you don't have Jesus at all. Then you're not saved tonight. Because I want to tell you something. Jesus is everything. He's all you need. He's everything in everything. Oh, give him praise. And he says, you'll be caught up, raptured, called out with the resurrected dead in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so always, through the eternity of the eternities, we shall be with the Lord. Now, I want you to understand that this is not the second coming. This is the rapture. The second coming is after the tribulation, after the great tribulation. This is not the great tribulation. This is the rapture. We're expecting this anytime. Come on. How many are expecting to go be with the Lord? Let me ask that question again. How many are really expecting to go be with the Lord? If you're not, don't worry about it. You won't. You'll be here. You'll stay here. You see, there are some people that no matter what they see, they won't believe it. You see, they just won't accept it. They won't believe whatever the Word of God says. See, they really believe. There are some people, listen, there are people that believe so many crazy things, man. I'm telling you the truth. There are some people that really believe, listen, they believe that they want to stay here for the tribulation and help people make it all the way through the tribulation. Brother, they ain't even going to be able to do that. The Word of God says that the tribulation days are going to be the worst days that the world has ever known from the very creation of it. There has never been days like the days that there's going to be from the very creation of it. There's never going to be days like the days that are coming. These days that are coming, church, are going to be the hardest days. Believe me, you don't want to be here. I don't want to be here. I want to be in heaven. I want to be with the Lord. I want to be caught up in the air. So the devil will do everything he can to keep you here. Anybody home? Look at this. Let's read on what he says here in the next one. Therefore, he says, comfort and encourage one another with his words. Comfort and encourage one another with his words. In other words, every day, when you see your brother, your sister, hey, don't give up, man. Don't go that way. Don't listen to these people. Don't get involved with stuff like that. We're waiting for the rapture. We're not going in any other direction. We're going up. Yeah. We're going up. Come on, we're going up. Yeah. We're going up. Yeah. Amen. Go with me to verse chapter 5. Look at chapter 5 with me. So I want you to see with me these things, but I want you to understand what the Lord is trying to say to you and I, because there are so many things that are happening right now that you know what, brother? Let me tell you something. I'm going to be so honest and truthful with you tonight. Brother, you got to get out of playing around with God. You got to get for real with the Lord. You know, if you're here tonight and you have unforgiveness in your heart towards somebody, you better start forgiving. If you're here tonight and you just have hatred and anger and there's people, you better ask God to give you love, because you know what? You're going to be left behind. You can't go to heaven with all that stuff in your heart. That stuff ain't gonna exist in heaven. It ain't gonna live there, I'm telling you. It's not gonna be there. Amen. If you wanna go hear from a false preacher, they'll tell you it's all right, you go ahead. But I'm telling you the truth tonight. You cannot live like that. You can't live with one foot in and one foot out and expect to go in the rapture. You cannot do that. I'm telling you tonight. If you're going to live for God, if you're going to be born again, you got to live for reals with God. You got to be born again. You can't have one foot in the world and one foot here thinking that God's going to take you like that. He's not going to listen to me. You can fool everybody else in the world, but you'll never fool Jesus. You can't live like that. See, I could give you a three-point message, point one, church, point two, point three. I could do that. I know how to do all that. I've been in this for 40 years. But I'm not, I gotta give you something that'll get you ready, church. I gotta give you something that'll speak to your spirit. Anybody home? Amen. Look at this. Go with me. Chapter 5. Don't get me started. Look at this. But as to the suitable times, what times? These times we're in. Look at this. And the precise seasons and dates, brethren, you have no necessity for anything being written to you. You don't have any need for anybody to write you and tell you. We know what day. We know what time it is on God's calendar right now. We know where we're at. We see the handwriting on the wall. Come on. How many of you see the handwriting on the wall? How many of you have your insurance rejected already? How many of you have your taxes going up and your insurance going up and all? Come on. You know what I'm talking about. Don't look at me like, duh. You know what's happening. It's all part of it. It's all a part of it. Preparing, they're setting the stage for the Antichrist. And you and I have got to get ourselves ready to fly. And we've got to get ourselves ready to take our families with us. We got to get our families in. And they've got to see us living for Jesus. Come on. They've got to see us for reals, living for God, being committed to the Lord. I mean, being for reals with God. Forget all the other stuff. Come on, is there anybody home? One thing I know about Jesus, one thing I know about the Word of God, He never changes. And the Word of God never changes. It stays the same. He said, my Word will never change. He said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my Word will never pass away. It remains. It'll always remain. Come on, are you with me tonight? Look what he says. But as to the suitable times and the precise seasons and dates, brethren, you have no necessity for anything being written to you. Let's go on. For you yourselves know perfectly well that the day of the return of the Lord will come as unexpectedly and suddenly as a thief in the night. When people are saying, all is well, is secure, and there is peace and safety, then in a moment of unforeseen destruction, ruin and death will come upon them as suddenly as labor pains come upon a woman with child, and they shall by no means escape, for there will be no escape. I'm telling you something, church. All everything is being prepared right now. Everything. Listen, look up here at me. No one wants to hear what's happening. Nobody wants to hear what's coming and what's going on. Are you with me, church? When we hear stuff like that, right away we put our guard up. Oh, no, I don't. We put our guard. But if you don't know and you don't understand, you'll never be ready for the rapture. Come on, you'll be flipping and flopping in every direction with all kinds of doctrines. You'll be believing everything that comes around. Is there anybody here tonight? Let's go on. But you are not given, you are not in giving up to the power of darkness. You weren't called, you weren't saved to give in to the power of darkness. You weren't called to follow the power of darkness. You were called to follow the Holy Spirit. Follow the light. Follow the light. Say, follow the light. Brethren, for the day to overtake you by surprise as a thief. You shouldn't be taken by surprise. You shouldn't be taken by surprise. Anybody home? Not any of us. Not any of us. None of us should have one foot in and one foot out. None of us. We should be in there totally committed to the Lord. How many understand that tonight? We should be committed to Jesus. Come on, look at your neighbor. Say, get committed to Jesus. You know the problem. Look up here at me. Look up here at me. You know the problem with the body of Christ. Look up here. Is that we have made so many excuses for sin. We have made so many excuses for so many people that they don't know, they don't even know what's right and wrong anymore. Do you know that nobody comes to me to ask me what I think? But they go to their friend in church? And then when things are falling apart and destruction's coming, then guess what? Then I find out about it. Huh? Look at this. Look at this, verse 5. For you are all sons of light and sons of the day. We do not belong either to the night or to darkness. How many here belong to the light? How many belong to the light? Look at this, verse 6. Accordingly then, let us not sleep as the rest do. He's giving us a warning there. He said, don't fall asleep. Don't let your guard down. Man, don't do that. Don't give in that way or this way. Don't get comfortable, man. Don't do that. He's saying, because then you'll land down in the wrong place. Accordingly then, let us not sleep as the rest do. Apparently, Paul is seeing in the church, he's seeing people sleeping. Christians were already going in the other direction. He's seeing that. That's why he wrote that. And he's writing that to warn them, to show them, listen, you don't want to miss the rapture. How many here want to really make the rapture? I want to make it, church. I don't, brother, if I gotta be the only one of this church going in the rapture, I guess I would be the only one. Look at this. But let us keep wide awake, alert, watchful, cautious, and on our guard. You gotta have that relationship with the Holy Spirit, with the Word. You got to be alert. He's got to be able to deal with you. He's got to be able to lead you. He's got to be able to speak to you. Don't believe your friend. Let me tell you something. Your friend's not the Holy Spirit. Love them, but man, don't give in to them for everything. Peer pressure. How many know what peer pressure is? How many have ever felt peer pressure? You know what peer pressure is? Your peers, whether family or friends, your peers pressuring you to do something they want you to do. And that's what our kids fall into, peer pressure. They're pressured into something they shouldn't do. But see, the church also is pressured. Peer pressure. So look at this. And let us be sober, calm, collective, and circumspect. Let's go on. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But we belong to the day. Therefore, let us be sober and put on the breastplate, corset of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God, now look at this. I want you to underline this verse, verse 9 in your Bible. And you need to understand this. You're not going to be here for the tribulation if you're living for God. If you're born again and you're living for the Lord and you've got your both feet in with Jesus, you can't have one foot in the world and one foot with God. You can't be teeter-tottering. You got to have both feet in. You can't live two lives, church. You got to have both feet in. I'm telling you tonight. Anybody home? Look at this. Are you here tonight? All right? Look at this. Because some people, I told you this morning, I had a guy that was coming to church here. Well, not here, but at the other church we were at. This guy believed that his ministry was to have sexual intercourse with every woman in the church. He told me that was my ministry. I got him by the hand. I led him to the door. I told him, go find you another place to do that. Because you're going to do that here. That's what he believed. I'm telling you. Anybody here? Did you lower me? Don't lower me, brother. I want him to hear me. Are you with me? I said, are you with me? Now look up here. Look up here. As gentle and as loving as I can be, you cannot be having sexual intercourse outside of marriage. That's right. You cannot be doing that. I'm telling you. You will miss the rapture. If you may as well tell this dude or tell that girl, you know what? I'm going to go to heaven. I'm born again. Say it with me. I'm born again. You can't do that. It's against the word of God. It's against the word. If you're going to give him praise, give him praise. And I'll show you in a minute. I'll show you in a minute. But look at this. For God has not appointed us to incur his wrath. The tribulation and the great tribulation is God's wrath being poured out on the people who have rejected his son. They have rejected Christ. They don't want him. We're living in that world today. Haven't you heard the news today? Don't you listen to the news? How they want to put everything that pertains to God out? How they want to silence your voice and my voice? Come on, you know that. You can't say nothing about God. You'll lose your job. Because they don't want nothing to do with God. Well, this is what God is saying right here to you and I. We're not appointed to that. We're not appointed to the wrath of God. The tribulation and the great tribulation is God's wrath being poured out on a people who have rejected his son. They have rejected Christ and his sacrifice for them. They want nothing to do with God. They want nothing to do with his sacrifice. They don't want to believe in him or nothing. And God is sending his wrath on the world. his judgment on the world. Are you with me, church? This is why he's going to pull us out of here. This is why you and I are going to be raptured in a twinkling of an eye, because you and I are not saved for wrath. Come on, give him praise. Look at this. For God has not appointed us to incur his wrath. He did not select us to condemn us, but that we might obtain his salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah. He says he didn't call us for wrath. He's going to pull us out of here. Are you with me, church? All right. Let me find out where we're at here. Now, look at this. Verse 10. Who died for us, that whether we are still alive or are dead. Remember? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. At Christ's appearing, we might live together with him and share his life. When he calls us, when he appears in the clouds, calls us out of here, we're going to share his life. Now, look at this. Let's jump down to verse 12. I want you to see this with me. Now also we beseech you, brethren, get to know those who labor among you, recognize them for what they are, acknowledge and participate, respect them all, your leaders who are over you in the Lord, and those who warn and kindly reprove and exhort you. That's what we're doing tonight. Anybody home? I said, anybody home? There is so much junk being poured out through television, through the airwaves, you name it, it's being poured out, man. I mean, your friends at work, every day. Listen, there's a new doctrine going on right now. They call it the he-she doctrine, where they believe they're half man and half woman. I don't know which one's going or which one's staying. Brother, you have got to be a mental case to really believe that stuff. You have got to have not 25 cents or 50 cents missing, but you got to have everything missing. Let's go on. Look at this. And hold them in a very high and most affectionate esteem and intelligent and sympathetic appreciation of their work, but be at peace amongst yourselves. And we earnestly beseech you, brother, admonish, warn, and seriously advise those who are out of line, the loafers, the disorderly, and the unruly. Encourage the timid and the faint-hearted. Help and give your support to the weak souls, and be very patient. And everybody always keeping your temper. Are you with me? Okay. Now, I want you to jump down with me. Amen. Okay, let's stop right there. Let's stop right there. Let's go with me to Timothy. Are you with me tonight? Yes. Well, before we go there, I said I was going to show you. Go to Galatians chapter 5. Okay. Look at verse 18 down. Okay, verse 18 down. Let's read that. But if you are guided and led by the Holy Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Is there anybody home? All right? Look at this. Now the doings or practices of the flesh are clear. Look at this. He said these are clear, obvious. They are immorality, impurity, indecency, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, ill temper, selfishness, divisions, dissensions, party spirit. There's no party spirits here.
Amen.
All right. Factions, sects, with peculiar opinions and hearsays, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and the like. I warn you beforehand, just as I did previously, that those who do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. All right? If those are the ones that are not led of the Spirit. Okay, who's got a different, who's got a King James or a different translation? What kind of Bible you got? What is that you're saying, verse 19 down? Give me a double microphone.
Now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness,
lasciviousness,
idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife,
seditions,
heresies, envying, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
That heavy?
Amen.
All right. So there. Okay. Go with me to Timothy. 2 Timothy. Are you with me tonight? How many want to go in the rapture? How many are expecting to go in the rapture? How many are not? So we can pray for you. Nobody's copying? All right, chapter 3. All right. From verse 1 to 5, we're going to read that, and then we're going to jump down. Okay, let's read this. Let's read this. This is what's happening in our time. All right? Let's read it so you can understand what's happening. Look at this. But understand this, that in the last days, say the last days.
Last days.
We're in the last days. That in the last days will come, said in perilous times of great stress, trouble, hard to deal with, and hard to bear. In other words, the pressure will be on you. The pressure will be on you. The pressure will be on you. Your friends, your family, people that you like will be on you to change, to do things differently, to abandon your faith, to just leave God, to do things that you would normally do. Are you with me? Let's go on. For people will be lovers of self and utterly self-centered, lovers of money, and aroused by an inordinate, greedy desire for wealth, proud and arrogant and contemptuous, boasters. They will be abusive, blasphemous, scoffing, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, profane. They will be without natural human affection, callous and inhuman, relentless, admitting of no truce or appeasement. They will be slanderers, false accusers, troublemakers, intemperate and loose in morals and conduct, uncontrolled and fierce haters of God. They will be treacherous, betrayers, rash and inflated with self-conceit. They will be lovers of sensual pleasures and vain amusements more than and rather than lovers of God. For although they hold a form of piety, true religion, They deny and reject and are strangers to the power of it. They conduct ballets for the genuineness of their profession. Avoid all such people. Turn away from them. Imagine what he's saying. This is going to be the falseness of what's happening and coming. Are you with me, church? How many have ever run into such a thing like that? Have you ever run into it? Amen. Now I want you to jump down with me. Amen. Let's go right to verse 13. I want you to see verse 13 with me. Look what it says. But wicked men. Now this is happening. They come in, man, and they begin to just invade your heart, your mind, and by the time you know it, you're all messed up, all confused. Don't know what to believe. But yet you got a Bible. Yet you say you got the Holy Ghost. But you're all messed up in your mind. And you don't know what to believe. You see, this is why I say you're either going to believe false things because that's what you want to believe, or you're going to believe the truth and get away from the false. See, when I gave my life to Jesus, I gave my life to Jesus because I was tired of what I was doing. I didn't want to live like that no more. I didn't want that life. I wanted to be free. I was in bondage. I didn't want that life. I had that life. When I came to Jesus, man, I came to him because I was told that he could set me free and give me a better life. That's why I came to him. Why would I want to come to Jesus and still be stuck in sin? Still be all messed up? Why would I want to come to the truth and live in falsehood? I might as well live in falsehood. I might as well stay in falsehood. You know what the Bible says? This is what the Bible says. The Bible says this in Revelation. It says, you that are pure, get more pure. And you that are filthy, get more filthy. You know why he says that? He says, because people don't want to change. People want heaven, but they don't want to let go of what's destroyed their lives, what's keeping them out of heaven. They want to hang on to everything that's keeping them out of heaven. Everything that Jesus died for to set them free from, they want to hang on to it, and yet they want to go to heaven. No, brother, listen to me. He paid a tremendous price. It costed him all his life. Every ounce of blood was drained from his body. Brother, believe me, brother, he's not going to take you in the rapture like that. You got to surrender everything you are. He wants your whole life. Everything you are, he wants it all. And I love you. I just don't have words like you know. I'm just not like Joel Osteen, you know. I'm just not like that, man. That's not me. I'm sorry. But brother, I want to see you in heaven. What good does it do you to have a good attitude about life and miss heaven? I'd rather be free. I want to be free. I want to live with Jesus. So look at verse 13. It says, but wicked men and imposters will go on from bad to worse. Listen, they'll come in, man, and instead of getting better, they'll get worse. Things are getting worse. Brother, now they want to believe they're half and half. They don't know which one's talking, which one's worshiping. Is it her or him? And I'm not trying to be funny with them. I mean, I feel sorry for them because, brother, they're confused. They're believing a false teaching. They're believing something that's not real. Jesus, listen to me. Jesus never makes mistakes. How many know our Creator never made mistakes? Our Creator doesn't create freaks. He created human beings. He knows what he was doing. Come on, he knows what he's doing. I remember one time, is Freddie back there? Where's Freddie? Hey, he's back there, I see his hand. I remember one time, Max Alva, remember Max Alva? He came to preach for me over here on Pier Street. And I think it was your cousin, Rose. She came to service that night, and Max Alva, I was sitting there, first time I ever saw somebody do that, but man, it worked. He pulled her out in front of everybody. He says, hey, you're not a man, you're a woman. He said, take your coat off. She took her coat off and he says, now look at yourself. He said, tell me you're a man. And I mean, he put his hand on her, man, the Holy Ghost zapped her. Am I right, Rose? God touched her that night there, and she's never forgot that. God don't make mistakes. But wicked men, imposters, will go on from bad to worse, deceiving. Look at this, deceiving and leading astray others and being deceived and led astray themselves. They're going to lead others astray. And if you don't believe like they do, they don't like you. You'd be surprised how many individuals, because I won't believe the way they do, don't like me. And that's okay. That's okay. I'm going to love them anyway because I'm going in the rapture. I'm going, church. But I don't understand. Why would a person want to, listen, if I was going to live the way I was living, I'd just stay there. Forget it. Mejor me quedo en el mundo. Why fool yourself if I was going to live like that? No, church. I'm going to go to heaven. I want to do it right. I want to understand that. If I'm going to go to heaven, I'm going to do it God's way because that's the only way to go. Can't go no other way. Come on, how many know that? You can't go no other way. He wrote the instructions. I mean, have you ever searched for treasure? How many of you have ever been given a treasure map or a map to go somewhere? Or have you ever been given directions to go somewhere? And they give you a map, and even though they're... But if you don't follow those directions, your life will get lost. And you got to follow his directions, and he'll get you there. How many understand? He'll get you there. He'll get you there all the way. I mean, he'll get you there all the way. Pastor, don't mess with my life. Leave my life alone. These are my hidden things. I like these things. No, church, you need to empty those things out because you got to go to heaven. I want to see you make the rapture. Yes. Say, I got to make the rapture. Look at this. Look at this. He says this. But wicked men and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and leading astray others, being deceived and led astray themselves. Now look at the next verse. Look what he says. But as for you, continue to hold to the things that you have learned and of which you are convinced, knowing from whom you learned them. Hold on to them. Don't change. Keep holding on to them. They might call you old school. They might call you backwards. They could call you weirdo. They'll call you whatever they want to call you. It don't matter. Just don't call me late to the rapture. Hallelujah. I'm going. Hallelujah. It don't matter what they call you. In fact, I'm going to tell you something. The more they call you names, the more you know you're on the right track. Praise his mighty name. Amen. Go to chapter 4. Verse 3 and 4. Look what he says. Because this is happening. This is in our time. This is in our time. And people don't believe. They really, listen to me. You talk to them and you can tell them. You try to tell them the truth, you can show them the word, and they won't believe the word. You can show them the word of God, black and white, and they won't believe it. Because they want to believe falsehood. They want to believe in things that satisfy the flesh. But they're not going to make it like that. Look at this. For the time is coming when people will not tolerate it or endure sound and wholesome instruction. That we're in that time. We're living that day right now. We get up here sometimes. Believe me, we get up here sometimes and we say, we're in the last day and right away. Well, I'm sorry, but that's where we're at. We can't turn the clock back, man. We're in that day. We're in it. We might as well get ready. We may as well enjoy it. Enjoy serving the Lord and get ready to blast off. For the time is coming when people will not tolerate or endure sound and wholesome instruction, but having ears itching for something pleasing and gratifying, they will gather to themselves one teacher after another to a considerable number chosen to satisfy their own liking and to foster the errors they hold. Imagine trying to find somebody to tell me, it's all right, don't worry about it, God don't care about all that. You're okay, it's cool. You're covered by grace. Just cover it with a shawl. Amen. You're all right. Oh, church. Uh-uh. How many understand?
Amen.
Come on, how many understand? We got to be ready. We got to be right.
Amen.
Amen. Look at this. And will turn aside from hearing what? What? Say it out loud. Don't be afraid of the devil. We're putting the devil to run tonight. Come on. And turn aside from what?
The truth.
The truth. From hearing the truth and wander off into myths and man-made affections. Can you imagine? And wander off into man-made affections. What a trip. This is happening. It blows your mind. It blows my mind. We sit down sometimes to talk. We say, what happened to that brother, man? He was on fire. What happened? I am with Cinderella. I don't know where. What? Yeah. said, wow. That verse, we're in that hour, church. And why is all that happening? Look up here at me. It's demonically orchestrated. There are ministers of the gospel tonight that don't even know, don't even realize they have swayed from the truth, and the enemy has taken over, and they're being used by the enemy. Listen to me tonight. They're being used by the enemy tonight to deceive people, and they don't really even know it. They really believe they're in the truth. Anybody home?
Amen.
Go back with me too. Are you with me? Go with me to 2 Thessalonians. I want you to see this with me, and then we're going to pray. I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. I want to pray that God will help us be ready, every one of us. That God will help us be ready. That God will take a hold of us. That God will give us the strength and the courage to let go of whatever we're holding on to that don't belong to Him. That God will help us to stop doing whatever we're doing that does not please Him. That we'll stop. Look at this, chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians. I'll read it. I'll start reading it. Anybody here? All right. But relatively to the coming of the Lord, I'm going to read it for you real quickly here. But relatively to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, and our gathering together to meet Him, we beg you, brethren, not to allow your minds to be quickly unsettled or disturbed or kept excited or alarmed, whether it be by some pretended revelation of the Spirit or by word or by letter alleged to be from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has already arrived or is here. Listen to me. There are people that believe all kinds of stuff. Listen, when it comes, if you're living for Jesus and you're right with God, when it comes, you'll know, because you won't be here no more. You're going to be with Him. Are you with me? Let's go on. Let no one deceive or beguile you in any way, for that day will not come except the apostasy comes first. And look at this. The apostasy means that people, Christians, falling away from truth to false teaching, leaving the faith for false teaching. And we see it by the hundreds. I mean, people just embracing false teaching. Look at this. Let no one deceive you or beguile you in any way, for that day will not come except the apostasy comes first. Unless the predicted great falling away of those who have professed to be Christians has come, and the man of lawlessness or sin is revealed, who is the son of doom, of perdition. Now we know he's talking about the Antichrist. Let's go on. Who opposes and exalts himself so proudly and insolently against the over all that is called God or that is worshipped, even to his actually taking his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming that he himself is God. Do you not recollect that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining him. Now look at this. Now you know what is restraining him from being revealed at this time. It is so that he may be manifested, revealed in his own appointed time. For the mystery of lawlessness, that hidden principle of rebellion against constituted authority, is already at work in the world. But it is restrained, now look at this, it is restrained only until he who restrains is taken out of the way. And he's talking about the church, the people that are filled with the Holy Spirit. We are holding back the hand of the Antichrist from taking over completely. Are you with me, church? Once the church is raptured, the Antichrist is taking over completely. There's nothing that's going to hold him back. Are you with me? And all hell will break loose on this world like the world has never seen it before. And I want to tell you tonight, you don't want to be here when that happens. You want to go to heaven. You want to be one of the ones that makes the rapture. Don't be left behind. You want to go in the rapture. I'm telling you tonight, put both feet in with Jesus. Don't leave one foot out and one foot in. Put both feet in with Jesus. I want you to stand. I know tonight this has been hard at times, but it has to be. It has to be. Because the Bible says that the truth will set you free. I want you to bow your head with me. Before we do anything, if you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're not born again, you have not accepted Him as your Lord, your Master, but you want to. You want Him to come into your heart. I'm just simply going to ask you to lift your hand, because we want to pray for you. We want Jesus to write your name in His book. God bless you. Anybody else that'll say, I want Jesus to come into my heart? Anyone else that'll say, I want Him to come? Let me have this young man come. I want to pray with him. Did he lift his hand? We want to pray with him. Did you lift your hand? Come. We want to pray for you. Anybody else, if you don't know him or you're backslidden, if you're backslidden tonight, listen to me. If you got one foot in the world and one foot in church, you need to come. You need to get right with God. You can't have one foot in and one foot out. I'm telling you. The trumpet will sound, and you'll get left behind. I want you to extend your hand out this way. Pray this prayer with me. Say, dear God in heaven.
Dear God in heaven.
I come before you.
I come before you.
And I confess.
I confess.
With my heart.
With my heart.
And my mouth.
With my mouth.
That you are the Son of God.
You are the Son of God.
And you died for me.
And you died for me.
And you resurrected from the dead.